Good morning. For those of you who don't know who I am, if you're tuning in live, I'm Jessica. I'm the music director here at Northside. Rachel had surgery on her mouth this week, so she's home recovering. She's recovering well, but she needed a little bit more time to get back to 100%. So I know she'll appreciate your prayers and your emails, just checking in on her. If you're worshiping with us online, know that the bulletin, form to register your attendance, and giving link are all pinned to the top of the church Facebook page so that you can fully participate with us. And if you're in here, you can also access the bulletin that way as well. Next Sunday, August 23rd, from 4 to 5 p.m., we will do a drive-through back-to-school blessing, which is open to anyone. Simply drive through our parking lot between 4 and 5, stop at the specified station for a prayer over everyone in your vehicle, and receive a special tag to carry with you this school year. We are rooting for you as you enter this very different school year. This Wednesday at 10:30 a.m., Pastor Rachel is hosting a workshop for anyone who'd like to become more comfortable navigating all of our online offerings like Facebook, YouTube, and Zoom. Please call the church office to RSVP. I strongly encourage you to take that workshop if you're not comfortable with all the technology. This is the direction we're going to be in, I think, for quite some time. Because of that technology, last week when Lance and I were on our way back from the beach, we were able to watch the live service. So while we weren't here in person, we were still with you. And I have no doubt Rachel's actually with us probably right now, even from her house watching live. So this will probably be the future forever. So we don't want you to be left behind or feel left out. So make sure you come to that workshop and get some help. If you can't come then, I'm sure Rachel will be willing to help you any other time. This morning, we welcome with us Reverend Edward McCutcheon, who's the campus minister of the Wesley Foundation at Furman University. We are so glad that he is helping to lead us this morning in worship. And then a reminder that if you attend worship and later test positive for COVID-19, make sure you give us a call right away so we can take all the necessary measures. And then I believe Bill had one more announcement. We are collecting school supplies for Miss Carolyn's granddaughters for the next 2 weeks. A revised list is in the narthex and will be emailed tomorrow. Supplies may be dropped off in the container outside during the week. Excess supplies will be donated to a school. So keep Miss Carolyn's grandkids in mind, and when you're just doing any kind of grocery shopping, grab that list from the narthex and just pick up some supplies. I know they'll be used well. We are going to open with Open Our Eyes, Lord. And to my disappointment, while we still can't sing as a congregation, I hope you'll open up your bulletin. I hope you'll really think on those words, hum along, and if you're at home, I hope you'll still sing along with Lanzen and I. Open our eyes.
Bye. Good morning to those who are gathered here at Northside and those who are watching from wherever you are. I invite you to join us for our call to worship. Let us pray together. O God, we trust in your power, even as it is often found in weakness. We trust in your wisdom, even as it is expressed in seeming foolishness. We trust in your wholeness, even as it comes to us amid brokenness. We do not ask this day for dazzling displays of strength or marvelous manifestations of miracles. We come simply to worship you. Touch us this day, O Lord, sinners that we are, that we might become your saints, your body, your children, your church. For this temple of your spirit is built not upon our own abilities, knowledge, or skill, but upon your Son, our foundation, Jesus Christ. And now let us continue by affirming our faith using words from 1 Corinthians 15 and Colossians 1. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand and by which we are saved. Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised on the third day, and appeared first to the women, then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the faithfulness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body, the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen. It is our great privilege to offer not only our gifts and our tithes, but also our service, our witness to the world. So let us now take this moment as the music is played to reflect on the ways that we can give back to build God's kingdom in our world.
Will you join me in reading from 1 Corinthians 3, verses 10 through 11, then 16 through 23. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Do not deceive yourselves. If you think that you are wise in this age, you should become fools so that you may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, He catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. So let no one boast about human leaders, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all belong to you, and you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning again. It is good to be back at Northside. I think this is the second time that I have filled in here at Northside. I can't remember how many years ago it was, but when Elizabeth Thompson was your pastor, she asked me to come and lead and be a part of your worship. And it is good that we are here. I was reflecting as we were doing the prelude that we are familiar with the Beatitudes, blessed are they, and all that comes after. There's one that's little known that maybe you've heard. It's called Blessed Are the Flexible, for they shall not be bent out of shape. And I feel like during this time of COVID and pandemics and online worship and doing new old things in new ways, that is a good word for us. As it has been said, I do direct the Wesley Foundation at Furman University. Our Wesley Foundations are campus ministries across the United Methodist Church. And so we start this week online classes and in-person classes and all that that will entail. And so we do ask for your prayers that as half of our students will be on campus and the other half will remain at home, that this year will be a blessing for all. We hear these words from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. And we hear Paul talking about building and foundations and those who build upon that foundation. And I must be honest with you, I have a love-hate relationship with anything that involves building. Because I feel very inadequate when asked to build anything or to fix anything. And then when it's done, I feel a sense of accomplishment. This was never more apparent to me than the years that I spent going to Sakahatchee with some youth or some young adults. One year we were down in Mount Pleasant at the college and young adult Sakahatchee. And we arrived at our house that first day to learn that we had two major projects. The first major project was we had to take the shingles and all the roofing off, as you can imagine, a common occurrence, and re-roof the house. The other was that we needed about four people to crawl underneath the house and spend the week with jacks, with cement blocks, with big pieces of wood to jack up the foundation, the floor of the house, to make it more secure, to make it more level. Now, being one of the adults on the house, it was required that at least one of us over the age of, say, 25 or 30, go underneath the house for that part of the project. And as you can imagine, I was the top of the list, being a slight of build, seeing there wasn't a lot of room under there. So I spent that week with three other folks underneath the house, jacking and leveling and supporting. I can't tell you it was the most fun week, but I can tell you that on top of the house, it was 100 plus degrees, and underneath the house, it was a nice, comfortable 70 to 75. So at least there was that silver lining. I felt very inadequate, but we got through the week. And when we crawled out on that Friday afternoon, a job well done, we walked back inside the house, and all the doors would close and latch. The floors and the ceilings were plumb with the walls. Even the toilet did not wobble when you sat on it for the first time in 15 years. All because we had spent the week shoring up the foundation of the house. And by doing so, it made everything else in the house solid, secure, and in alignment. Now, I imagine as you reflect on the last 4 years, 4 years, 4 months, excuse me. Whew, I hope we don't have to deal with this for 4 years. The last 4 months of your life, maybe there are things in your life that feel a little out of square, a little out of whack. Things don't seem to fit as they once did. I know I feel this way in my life. And I think these words from Paul about a solid and sure foundation is a reminder to us all that even when our lives feel a little out of kilter, that we come back. We come back to that foundation. The foundation that is Jesus Christ, that is our faith. And maybe by looking at and focusing on the foundation, the one thing that unites us, that holds us together, things will become a little more in line and fit together. Now we know Paul is writing to the Corinthians. And earlier in the passage, right before where Landon began to read today, we read about how they're fighting amongst themselves. They're fighting about who has it right. Some say Paul had it right. Some say Cephas was the better teacher. Some say Apollos was the one who had it just right. And Paul is getting a little frustrated with the folks. He's getting frustrated because they are fighting amongst themselves about things that don't really matter. And so we pick up that same conversation now. And Paul, speaking to them, says, "According to the grace of Christ given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. And each builder must choose with care how to build. For no one can lay a foundation other than the one that has already been laid. And that foundation is Christ." Paul started this church, or helped to start this church in Corinth. He's what we would call today a church planter. He had a lot of ownership. He had a lot of concern for what was going on amongst these people. But he noticed that things weren't going so well. And he noticed that those who continued to build, you know, it's not like Paul started this church on day one and everything was done. The church in Corinth, like the church at Northside, continues to evolve and adapt. We go from only in-person worship to only online worship to now a hybrid of online and in-person worship. We begin to understand more about the world, and we continue to build upon that solid foundation that has been laid before us. You know, it's not like when you build a house, you just build the foundation and then that's it, right? My parents built a house some years ago, a new house. They had lived in the same house for 30 years. And as they were getting older, they required a house that was all one level, not multi-level. So they built a house, a new house. 4 years after living in that house, they had their master bathroom completely gutted and had to be redone. And it was because after they laid this solid foundation and they began to build, people began to build upon it. The bathroom wasn't built correctly. There were pieces of it that didn't fit together just right. And what was happening is every time they turned on the shower, water would leak from the bathroom into their master bedroom and was ruining the hardwood floors. You see, after that foundation was laid, after Paul started this church, there were pastors and ministers and lay people and people who came, and together they continued to build. They continued to spread the message of Jesus Christ to a world that is dark and hurting. They continued to call folks to come and be a part of the body of Christ. How many of you here at Northside, here in the sanctuary, here at home, feel like for the last 4 or so months you have been rebuilding the church? You had a system. It all worked. Or maybe it didn't all work, but it mostly worked and everything was great, and every once in a while there was a hiccup. But now, it's like we're rebuilding it all over again. We've got to figure out if the camera's gonna work. We have to figure out if the microphone's gonna work. We have to feel like what it looks like on the other end. Is our internet strong enough? It just feels, is any of this resonating with anybody, or am I the only one who kind of feels this way? Like, this is the first time I've been to Northside in years, and I feel the tension. I mean, I feel the stress of making sure everything works just right. We feel like we're rebuilding the church all over again. And Paul's message to us today is, you are adapting, but the foundation is solid. He's also reminding us that the church is not this building. It's not this sanctuary. It's those of us who are gathered here. It's the people who are gathered at home watching us. We are the ones that make up the church. You know, when I was young, when you were young, we used to have a little saying. The saying went something like this: this is the church, this is the steeple, open the door and see all the people. Look, I see some of you here in the sanctuary doing it with me, right? This is the church, this is the steeple, open the door and see all the people. We are the ones who make up the church. But oftentimes, maybe we get so busy, we get so stressed or anxious about the world we live in that we don't really live into that mantra too much. And this is an easy time today to get caught up in all the things. How often should I wash my hands? Should I wear my mask? Should I not? How far can I be from someone? Who are the people that I can be around? And it's hard for us to get distracted from the message, from the love of Christ, spreading the grace and mercy to others. And I think this is what Paul is reminding the Corinthians about. He's not reminding them that there were these builders who came in and built these grandiose temples. He's reminding them that Christ called them with the simple words, "Follow me." With the simple words, but the hard to do task of love one another. He's saying that he's not talking about these bricks and these beams and these pews and this pulpit. He's talking about you and I and how we are the body of Christ and how we must work and continue to work and strive to continue to build this church in this world that we know. The city of Corinth was diverse. There were people coming and going. It was a trade route. People were transient. People were moving in. People were moving out. I don't live in the North Main area, this area that Northside resides, but I imagine that it's a neighborhood around us that people move in sometimes and people move out, in and out. It's a diverse city we live in Greenville. The world is more diverse. People are in and out, traveling all over the place. We're busy. And so we can relate to the city of Corinth. We can relate to the people to whom he is talking, because we don't all think alike. We don't all talk alike. We all don't all believe alike in every aspect of our lives. But Paul is saying, rest on that foundation, the foundation of Christ, that love, that grace, that mercy. He's saying, do you not know that God's temple dwells in you? You, me, we are God's temple. We are the representatives to the world. He is telling the Corinthians, he's telling us that as the church grows and moves and progresses, that it is the work of God through us that continues to build on that foundation laid 2,000 years ago. I was reading this week, sometimes when we talk about foundations of buildings, we talk about footings, we talk about, it gives the footprint of the building. The foundation gives the footprint of the building. Now, as I was thinking about that idea of a footprint, I was reminded of times that my wife and I go hiking. I grew up down near Myrtle Beach. I was reflecting on walking on the beach. Just yesterday, we went over to my in-laws' house, and they live out in the country, and I was walking on a dirt path. In all of these instances, what I was reminded of is my footprint. You know, you could tell a lot about someone's footprint, but the two main things you can tell about a footprint is you can tell from where someone came and the direction in which that person is going. I like that image when we think about the church. That footprint. From where have we come? And to where are we going? I think that's a powerful message. That's a powerful image to think about our foundation of Christ. We take what we got from Christ, what Christ laid for us, what the disciples laid for us, what the forefathers and foremothers of Northside United Methodist Church presented to us from where we came. And then we pass that along to those who journey with us and those who will journey after us to where we are going. You and I are called to continue building, building on the one sure, strong foundation of Jesus Christ. And as such, we are called to learn from those who have gone before us and journey with those who are with us now, and provide that strong base for those who come after us. We build for the future. As I end, I want to end with two thoughts. One, well, both from my personal life, two illustrations. But when I think about my own life, I'm reminded of my journey of faith that has led me from a small child at First United Methodist Church in Conway, South Carolina, to where I stand today here at Northside. You see, when I was in the fourth grade, I went through confirmation class and was confirmed at my church. The minister, the pastor who led my confirmation class was Ben Cunningham. And I didn't realize at the time the part that he would play in my own role of becoming a minister, the model of his ministry that I would model my own ministry after. And there's a lot about the way he did ministry that I do ministry. Now jump 35 years. Church here in Greenville, pastor on an extended leave. They asked me to fill in at the church for a few months. During that spring, they were having a confirmation class. I helped out with the confirmation class. And in that confirmation class was a young man whose grandfather was Ben Cunningham. You see, we never know what we build today, how it will become a foundation for what may come later. And when I think about Northside United Methodist Church, I am reminded of the summer of 1997. I had just completed my first year at Duke Divinity School. I was appointed to come to St. Matthew United Methodist Church in Greenville, South Carolina, for my first field ed experience. The associate pastor of St. Matthew at the time was Elizabeth Thompson. Elizabeth Thompson served as your pastor, but she was a mentor to me as a young seminary student. I'm reminded of my first Sawcahatchee camp in the summer of 2000, and reminded of one of the camp leaders named Don Brown, who not only helped me during that Sawcahatchee week, but also helped me in my role as a youth pastor at KC United Methodist Church in my first appointment. And today, I am reminded of Rachel and the fact that she and I get to share the experience of being in a covenant group together. And not only do we navigate life, not only do we navigate COVID-19, not only do we navigate ministry, but we share a friendship. We share the opportunity to share what's going on in our lives and in our ministries with one another and to have support. I tell you these examples just to highlight the fact that when Paul says a firm foundation was laid and we continue to build on it, that this world we live in seems awful big sometimes, and other times it seems awful small. And we seem very interconnected. And for this reason, I think this passage is a great reminder that the ceiling we build today might just be the floor upon which someone else stands and shares in the ministry of Jesus Christ, shares love, shares grace, shares mercy, and most importantly, maybe shares hope. Amen. I invite us to turn our hearts and our minds now, join them together, and let us pray together. Let us remember all those in our lives, those that we know well, those that we might only read about or hear about on the news. Let us have in our minds and in our hearts all those that needs God's prayer, all those that are experiencing joyous times and for which we give praise and thanks, but especially those who need to hear and need a touch of God's Holy Spirit. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we certainly thank you for this day. I am very grateful to Northside United Methodist Church, to Rachel for the opportunity to come, to share in this ministry of yours, to continue to build on that strong foundation upon which has been laid for us. I am thankful for those who are assisting this morning, who are really doing the heavy lifting and making everything go and work together. Lord, I am thankful for a new day. I am thankful for the bright and warm sunshine. And even though we complain about how hot it is oftentimes, it is a reminder of your love for us and the warmth of that love. And Lord, I am just thankful for friendship, for fellowship, whether we are in person or whether we are watching online, just being able to stay connected to one another. Lord, we also lift up all those who are hurting, those who are experiencing recovery or are in illness or sickness. Lord, send your spirit of healing into their lives. May them be touched by your great mercy. Lord, for those who are lonely, for those who are stressful, for those who are anxious, send your spirit of peace and comfort and assurance. And for all of us and for our world, give us the wisdom to continue to reach out to one another. Give us the courage to understand how we can better be your faithful children, your disciples. And give us your love that we can share with one another. Lord, unite us together in these moments. Unite us together as we pray that prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is The Church's One Foundation, hymn 545, verses 1, 4, and 5. Now receive this benediction. May we all go forth with the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit this day and forevermore. Amen.